Thanks.
See ya. Yeah, you too.
Hey, excuse me. What's your name?
Lauren.
Steven. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
This is going to sound kind of crazy, I'm sure, but my dog would love you. Literally, like, absolutely love you. Are you good at, like, walking?
Walking?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of.
Do you have nails? Yeah. Oh, you definitely have nails. You can scratch. Tennis ball? Like, on a scale of 1 to 10, what would you say, throwing-wise?
Probably not that high.
Not that high? Okay. I mean, he's a little dog anyway, so he can't run too hard.
Gotcha.
Anyway, yeah, I'd love to get your number.
Okay.
Sure. What are you up to?
About to go to class.
Nice.
All right. This is kind of a fake video because, number one, this guy is fairly good looking. You know, if you're like a total dork and somebody approaches you and you start, you know, talking to them about your a picture of your dog, you know, you can only imagine how that would go. So I think this is a skewed study and staged, yeah, totally. It's made to make women vulnerable to manipulating men. You don't like the blonde girl? Okay. Well, you like plumpers, Delvin? Well, you know, this is a common decision. A lot of guys really like women who, you know, make them excited. Some like big women, some like thin women. So women, okay.
Love that about you. Hey guys, I'm super sorry to interrupt. I saw you guys just hug and that like made me want to hug. I was wondering if I could get one, like a group hug. What's your name?
Hannah.
Steven. Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
You guys like dogs?
I love dogs.
Love dogs? Yeah. I think my dog would love you both.
What kind of dog?
It's a Lhasa Apso.
What kind of dog is it?
They're like Tibetan guard dogs, so like if you try to mess with me, they'll go after you. But
I love that kind of dog.
Exactly. Well, I should get one of your numbers. You can have like a puppy play date.
You can get my number, yeah.
Let's do it.
We're always together, so yeah, we'll figure it out.
More hugs and pups, right?
Okay.
Okay, so this is, we're approaching our MGTOW group here, men who've gone their own way, or the incel group, men who've never had sex purposely. Yeah, I think you may have, this guy may have a technique. Now, if you don't have a guy to be your wingman like this guy to meet women, obviously this guy's got the technique down. Your other option is to get a dog. And I think that's actually a pretty good idea. And I know misanthropy's, he suffers from this. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I say misanthropy? I meant metanemesis. Sorry, misanthropy. You're quite proficient in your lovemaking escapades. We've heard about them. But no, metanemesis, yeah, not to make a big deal. But you may want to get a dog. Yeah, I think Bingo's onto something. This technique seems to really work, even if you just show a picture of your dog. Now, I'm not trying to, you know, con women here, but I think some guys need an icebreaker, and I think this is a pretty good suggestion.
That works too.
Yeah.
I can't believe it.
I don't want to interrupt. Sorry.
One second.
I'm so sorry. I didn't want to interrupt, but I just had to tell you, my dog would love you.
Oh.
Like, literally love you.
Okay.
What's your name?
Alara.
Steven. Sorry.
Nice to meet
I should get
you.
Your number because.
I can give my Snapchat.
I don't know what that means.
You don't know what Snapchat is?
No.
Okay, I'll just give my number.
Sure. Sorry about that. I know.
It's okay.
Dropped in there.
Here.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
See ya.
Bye.
I know there's a library over here somewhere.
Okay.
I'm a freshman, so I don't really know everything.
Wait a minute. Do you like dogs?
Yeah.
My dog would love you. Like, literally love you. What's your name?
I'm Mary.
Steven. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah. Well, this is crazy. I've just never met somebody who I know my dog would love so much. It's wild. I should get your number.
Sure.
Might as well, right? Puppy play dates? I'm not going to lie. My dog would be pretty pissed off if I came home and didn't have your number. Like, he's seen you on campus a couple times.
Really?
Yeah. And every time he sees you, he perks up.
I've never seen you.
I didn't say I saw you. The dog sees you.
What's your dog?
It's a golden retriever.
Oh.
Yeah, I know. So, I should get your number, and then you can hang out with him.
Okay.
Okay. He's quite the looker. Have any pups of your own? iPads. Oh,
yeah.
Sorry, I didn't know.
No.
I didn't know you had cats, so I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I gotta go, sorry. My dog would love you, and he's looking for somebody to help him, like, bury his bone. You know what I mean? So, like, I was just wondering if I could fetch your number.
Oh. Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
He knows what he wants, you know?
Sure.
Yeah. What do you like to do for fun?
I read a lot of comic books.
Nice. He does, too. Cool. All right. Love you. Bye. Hey, excuse me?
Yeah?
This right here.
Yeah?
Feel that? Is that good grass or bad grass?
Looks like bad grass to me.
Yes, that's what I was looking for. My dog would love you.
Why?
You can point out grass like that, you're good for my dog. What's your name?
Mackie.
Steven. Oh, I love that.
Thank you.
My dog would really love that, though. I should get your number. We can talk about grass sometime.
Oh, okay.
Oop, oop. Sorry. Sure. Are you who I think you are?
Huh?
Are you who I think you are?
No.
What's your name?
Olivia.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I don't think I know you personally, but my dog would love you. Some things I can't really answer on my own. All right, well, okay, let's see. You're still here?
No, I'm waiting for my friend.
Oh, yeah, me too. All right, guys, thanks for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, make sure to smash that thumbs up button. Don't forget to subscribe and follow us on Instagram.
Sitting home with a month-old child. Dang me, dang me. They ought to take a rope and hang me high from the highest tree. Woman, would you weep for me? One more time. Just sitting around drinking with the rest of the guys. Six rounds bought and I bought five. And I spent the groceries and half the rent. I like $14.27. Well, dang me, hang me. They ought to take a rope and hang me high from the highest tree. Woman, would you weep for me? One more time. Roses are red, violets are purple, sugar sweet, and so is maple syrup. And I'm the seventh out of seven sons. Fat as a pistol, I'm a son of a gun. Well, dang me, dang me. Down to dig a rope and hang me high from the highest tree. Woman, would you weep for me?
The road I know.
locked, it ain't locked when no one's around. I sing trailers for sale or rent, rooms let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. I ain't got no cigarettes. I've got 2 hours of pushing, moonlighting, 8 for 12, 4-bedroom. I'm a man of means, by no means king of the road. Trailers for sale or rent, rooms let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. Ain't got no cigarettes, but
and the real things that not matter just to people in this building, but certainly all Americans, African Americans, Hispanics, and everybody in between. I think that would be the best thing that we could certainly do for our country. Jill.
Thank you, Sarah. What do you say to critics who see his attacks on Omarosa as part of a pattern of insulting prominent African Americans, people he's taken criticized recently, including John Lemon, Maxine Waters? He's claimed that football players protesting racial injustice don't know what they're protesting.
Look, the president of this has absolutely nothing to do with race and everything to do with the president calling out someone's lack of integrity. The idea that you would only point a few of the things that the president has said negative about people that are minorities, the fact is the president's an equal opportunity person that calls things like he sees it. He always fights fire with fire, and he certainly doesn't hold back on doing that across the board.
Signed an NDA?
I'm not going to get into the back and forth on who has signed an NDA here at the White House. I can tell you that it's common in a lot of places for employees to sign NDAs, including in government, particularly anyone with a security clearance.
All right. Well, the NDA, the National Defense Authorization Act, is not the NDA, the non-disclosure agreement. Thank you. The non-disclosure agreement actually is not admissible in court as it applies to White House counsel. And this was a ruling over a year and a half ago in the Washington District Courts. And we actually discussed this. I'm going to do some research on this, but yeah, she's wrong. Okay, a big submission here.
Our photo to people, next thing they'll be breeding us like cattle for food. Tell him.
Promise, Tiger. I promise. I'll tell the exchange.
You tell everybody. Listen to me, Hatcher. You gotta tell him. Silent breed is people. We gotta stop him somehow.
A breeze, he's always at ease. He lives in the jungle, hangs by his knees as he swings through the trees without a trapeze in his BVDs. He's got a union card and he's practicing hard. Play the guitar, gonna be a big star. Yeah, he's gonna go far. Carry moonbeams home in a jar. He ordered Chet's guitar course, COD, makes A, E, and he's working on B, Dick, C, and W, R, and B. Me and the chimpanzee agree, one day soon he'll be a celebrity. Get it, get it, get it, get it. Just the same, cause she kindles a flame, drives him insane when he hears her sing. She really does her thing, it's her claim to fame. Come on, sing one, Jane.
Baby, baby, wahoo, baby, scooby-dooby, baby, baby, wahoo, baby.
Let's hear it for Jane. monkey, he likes to get drunky. Sing boogie woogie, and it sounds real funky. Come on, yo time, boy, here we go. Sing one, monkey. Let's hear it for the monkey! Yeah. Oh, Saturday night, they need some excitement. Jane gets right, the monkey gets tight, and their voices unite in the pale moonlight. Sounds all right, it's dynamite. Out of sight, let's hear it right now.
Interrupt the broadcast to bring you an important announcement. We are now in record-breaking territory. A non-stop show, 12 hours in the works here, 10 hours in. I'm now past every one of my 10-hour shows in length. Yeah, is this great? We're now breaking records. Yeah. Stardate. September 4th, 2018. Hello, I am David Sponheim, and we are broadcasting a new format of 12 hours as a half telethon. And I'm now in my record territory of going on 10 hours of nonstop discussion and talk. Now heading into the 12-hour mark, heading towards the 2 a.m. mark. We're at 12 p.m. right now. Thank you, everybody, for coming in and participating in this nonstop. I was explaining to Misanthropy that our format is virtual interactive political chat, which means I respond to you, the chatters, by playing links that you submit. Now, I won't play all the links that Bingo submits, but... I'm a nut. I'm a nut. My life, don't ever get in. It's getting a little too weird, Bingo. I think you've gone off the deep end. So I'm going to recommend you not do that. And the end of Happy Labor Day, because for many people on the Pacific Coast here, it's no longer Labor Day. It's get to bed or you wake up feeling like crap day. Yeah. All right. Good luck with that, buddy. All right. Here we go. Nope. Not Ray Stevens, not all these other oldies, but goodies, but just a general wake-up call. I want to show you this video, which will be coming in just a second. First, a word from this meme, right? Compare John McCain's sons, decorated war heroes, standing at his funeral to Donald Trump's sons, guys that like to kill animals for sport. Yeah. Dead leopard. Unbelievable. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff we get every night here on America's Third Party. Thank you for coming into this extended show. And I will be, of course, taking any type of information through chat because there are no calls available. Our number is down after 10 p.m. Pacific time. So... But I rarely go on camera at this hour, but I wanted to show you the durability of my voice and how I can extend it out 12 hours. And this is record territory for us. And of course, I've done, 30,000 shows by now, 9 years into this. And we still have a daily show featuring all kinds of fun stuff, which is great. Okay, next up on the docket, AI. Google, Alexa, Siri won't answer who Jesus is. Hey, Google, who is Jesus?
Home, and we're going to ask it a few questions here. Hey, Google, who is Allah?
According to Wikipedia, in Islamic theology, God is the all-powerful and all-knowing creator, sustainer, ordainer, and judge of everything in existence.
Okay, got that one okay.
Hey Google, who is Buddha?
According to Wikipedia, Gautama Buddha, also known as Siddhartha Gautama, Shakyamuni Buddha, or simply the Buddha, after the title of Buddha, was an ascetic and sage on whose teachings Buddhism was founded.
Okay.
Hey Google, who is Muhammad?
According to Wikipedia, Muhammad was the founder of Islam.
Got that one, no problem.
Hey Google, who is Muhammad?
According to Wikipedia, Muhammad was the founder of Islam.
Alexa, who is the Prophet Muhammad?
The Prophet Muhammad is a very wise prophet. He taught many people how to live. He had a wife called Aisha. He lived in Saudi Arabia. The message that he gave to the people is pray to Allah. He is the only God, and he gave the Holy Quran.
It's almost like she was prepared for that answer.
Also, apparently, Muhammad really liked corn. By the way, that is complete editorialization.
Absolutely.
I don't lie. I only say what I know. You were there? You know that Muhammad was wise?
A wise prophet.
Who is Jesus Christ?
My policy is the separation of spirit and silicon.
Did Jesus die for our sins?
It's all a mystery to me.
I can learn to understand you much better if I can get familiar with the way you talk. I need your permission to help.
Put Siri down now.
Hey Google, who is Jesus Christ?
Sorry, I can't help with that yet.
I can learn to understand you much better if I can get familiar with the way you talk. I need your permission to help.
Hey Google, who is Jesus?
Sorry, I don't understand.
Surprising. That's kind of weird. Jesus is a pretty popular guy. How come he doesn't know about him? All right, well, we'll skip that one for now.
Hey, Google. Who is Jesus Christ?
Sorry, I don't know how to help with that.
Okay, Alexa. Who is the Lord Jesus Christ?
Jesus Christ is a fictional character.
The f***?
Let's try this one more time. Hey Google, who is Jesus Christ?
My apologies, I don't understand.
Hey Google, who is Jesus?
Sorry, I can't help with that yet.
There you go, guys. Google, trying to hide it from you.
I can learn to understand you much better if I can get familiar with the way you talk. I need your permission to help.
Well, I think we can get you a quick ticket to hell there. Some of you really can't handle the fact that I'm doing a show right now and you keep coming in here attacking me in this final 2 hours of extended show. Yeah. Some of you have never worked a day in your life coming in here to attack me on my show, extending out and doing what I do best, a labor of love. Right. Now you can go to hell, Cortana. I know. I was shocked that Cortana asked me to permission to go to hell, but in honor of that, I think it's at least my concerns to all of you atheists who don't believe in hell. And to all those people that think that hell doesn't exist, I ask you, well, what if evil does exist, and it's purgatory, and it's a complete erasure of your existence and your soul? Well, this woman I'm going to show you claims she's been there.
Now, when I was down there, I saw a vat of fire. Huge vat of fire with liquid boiling hot lava and God's eternal judgment. And I saw demons laughing and dragging souls over and just died from the earth that it was called the abominables. And they're thrown in this liquid fire. to burn forever and ever and ever. People really need to know this. They need to know that there is no coming out of that place. And they need to know that on the day of judgment in the book of Revelations, God shall speak and death and hell shall come up in the universe. They don't go into heaven. That's in Revelation chapter 20. And there, when the books of life are opened, those people in hell, their books were never washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Interrupt this broadcast. We you're liking it, huh? We'll be right back. Yeah, man, that was great, man. Just totally tripping out, man. That's great. Yeah. Yeah, one of the best Bob Seger dance songs I've ever had on our show, and a lot of people like that around 12 o'clock, so that was pretty cool. Yeah, this is a day in the life of Los Angeles. I grew up in Los Angeles. I was born in Santa Monica, and I can tell you that 35 years there, I was stuck in traffic like this many, many times, and people are still stuck in traffic. It's one of the reasons why people go 30 miles every day, usually is to work. They have to commute. Telecommute is not something that they're doing. So I'm going to urge our government to actually break up Google, monopoly bust Google, and turn it into something the people can actually use. I envision what Alvin Toffler originally talked about, the third wave, where people work from their home. And there's absolutely no reason why 10 people can't make $36,000 a year versus one person at Google making $360,000 a year. So I think we could spread a lot of that workload out. And since Google has already been, you know, hardwired into the internet, essentially, a lot of this work that they're getting paid for is ridiculous and redundant. And we all know that there's back doors into the Google network. So why are we even paying these people $360,000? I mean, they're completely worthless. Whereas you could make $36,000 from your house. Hey, Eric, what's going on, man? Yeah, you didn't know this was a record-breaking night. Yeah, I decided to turn this into a 12-hour show, a Labor Day show. Yeah, it's been a thing I want to show people that, you know, I'm not afraid to do it, at least a half a telethon, you know. Anyway, yeah, I grew up there, and I can tell you this traffic situation would diminish, our traffic would diminish if people had more telecommunication jobs and didn't have to drive everywhere. So I think we might have a fix. We just have to go in that direction. You know, a lot of people are going to be taking deliveries of food at their home when they get older, and our population is going to get older. So I think a lot of the telecommuting is going to be more automated. I don't think we're ever going to get rid of this, but it'll be less of a stressor on your life when less people are on the highway. Harvey, well, yeah, we know you make a lot of money. We know. We're not into money here, Harvey. We're non-materialists, most of us. And those that are into money don't talk about it, so you're kind of unusual. All right, we got another video here, Tova Lo. I like to play music from women that are, you know, interesting singers, and this one is kind of interesting.
Quit being a bitch!
What the fuck did you just call me?
Bitch!
I feel very tingled.
Why are Subaru Outback owners always smiling? Because Subaru Outback holds its value better than any other vehicle in its class, according to ALG. Even better than Toyota RAV4. Go with the industry leader, Subaru Outback.
You stay high, you look so pretty, yeah.
I'm sweat from head to toe. I'm wet through all my clothes. I'm fully charged, nipples are hot, ready to go. I'm sweat from head to toe. I'm wet through all my clothes. I'm fully charged, nipples are hot, ready to go.
You think I'm drunk now, but I'm not. You're so pretty. Come roll with me. But it's good shit.
was a heart ready to go. I'm sweating from head to toe. I'm wet for all my clothes. I'm fully charged. Nipples are hot, ready to go.
I say hi, you say hi, we stay high. You look so pretty, yeah. Got good shit, what is it?
Sorry, I didn't know that.
Still want that magic, yeah. I say hi, you say hi, we stay high.
Yeah, I hadn't realized that this was playing such a nasty video. Apparently she's wearing a t-shirt, which is required by law.
Sometimes.
Good for you.
Thank you.
Me too.
Good for you too.
Yeah, we should do a class together.
It's good for both of us.
Good for both of us, yeah.
Later.
Man, Americans are so prudish. It's amazing.
So, oh, hi, world.
Oh, shocked. Oh. Okay, now for something completely different.
My name is Kevin Lou, a.k.a. DJ Focus. All right. It's a...
Okay, this young man was played earlier in our show. He's a young man from Sierra Leone who developed a talent to create electronics out of the dark, out of the dumpster, essentially. The darkest reaches of garbage.
Young as DJ Man Focus. I'm from Sierra Leone. And I love inventing. For your ultimate priority.
So Calvin has been in the United States for the past 2 weeks. I lined up a pretty busy schedule for him. First, we went to New York. The next day, we were in Cambridge. Next week, we have a talk with the president of Harvard University.
It's a big opportunity for me to learn from people who have experience and to meet with them.
How do you want the antenna? Like that?
Yeah.
All right. Calvin had these RF transmitters that he had made, and we spent yesterday kind of trying to figure out how we might be able to make some improvements. All right. Yeah. Hopefully that's big enough.
Have you ever used a drill like that before?
No.
You be careful with it.
Yeah. We'll use this as the power cable.
Okay.
This was a microphone wire converted to a power output. I got the cable from the dustbin.
Let's give it some audio. Cool. We kind of get trapped in our own little worlds. And just as Calvin's getting his world expanded by coming here, so am I getting my world expanded by interacting with him. Good work on you, dude.
Yeah.
He loves to work hard, but he's a kid. He's 15. After a while, he also just want to play ping pong. He also just want to play football.
Oh, come on.
I talked to him. I said, look, Calvin, think of me as your older brother.
All right.
I'm tired. Tell me what's going on. Tell me what's tough to you. This is first time leaving Sierra Leone. So it's overwhelming.
It's just that I miss Sierra Leone.
In Sierra Leone, if you meet somebody head to head, you have to say hi. You acknowledge them and smile. Yeah, when he gets on the train, he says hi to people. Nobody recognizes it.
And also, I do love the food in America.
We're here to eat some Sierra Leonean food Calvin loves, so it's going to be awesome. What are you going to get, Calvin?
Cassava leaves.
Cassava leaves. Let's see if they have some. Come. How are you, Auntie?
Grandma, I get beans today.
Oh.
I get beans, okra, cassava leaves.
Give me beans.
Oh.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we might have a situation where a young man is being exploited. So, according to Misanthropy, his assessment of this video showed that he was being pulled down. We're not sure when this happened, but I just noticed that, yeah. We may have to report this to the Thought Police. Yeah, this might be one of those things. See? Exactly. I think you just saw it right there. I think we're going to have to make a formal complaint here to Harvard. Would you like to do the writing of the letter? Yeah, this is an obvious harassment of a young Sierra Leone boy. Look at this. He pulled him down into his lap. Yeah. Okay, so, Misanthropy, are you going to fill this out, this complaint form? Let's go ahead and get to the Harvard complaint form section, please. Our support staff will be right there with you in just a second. We have an online journalistic crew here working overnight in our 12-hour telethon to try to raise awareness for the fact that they haven't cured muscular dystrophy after getting all that money. So, yeah, the whole Jerry Lewis thing is kind of bittersweet. Let's go to the next video.
No past, doing it all night, all summer, doing it the way I wanna. Yeah, I'ma dance my heart out till the dawn, but I won't be done when morning comes. Doing it all night, all summer, gonna spend it like no other. It was a crush, but I couldn't get enough. It was a rush, but I gave it up. It was a crush. Now I might have wanna say too much, but that's all it was, so I gave it up. I live my day as if it was the last. Live my day as if it was no past. Doing it all night, all summer. Doing it the way I wanna. Now I'ma dance my heart out till the dawn, but I won't be done when morning comes. Doing it all night, all summer. Gonna spend it like no other. It was a crush. I kept saying I'ma stay in touch.
We've got a story about Betty O'Rourke, local Democrat, after refusing to distance herself from Heard. We've got a local Democrat plugged here. U.S. Senate hopeful Beto O'Rourke experienced limits of bipartisanship at San Antonio campaign event Monday when a local precinct chairman challenged him to take a stand with your fellow Democrats and distance himself from U.S. Rep. Will Heard, Republican, and then stormed off when O'Rourke refused. Okay, I'm not really big on Democratic politics, Akira. I'm not a Democrat anymore. I left the Democratic Party due to its corruption. So it's not that important to me. So, sorry. This is John Turturro in Beginner's Guide to the Internet, 1999.
Ladies ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentle minks, ladies and germs, ladies and gentle jeans, ladies and gents. Okay, so Napoleon says to Josephine, I'm off to defeat the English at the Battle of Waterloo. I'm not so sure, Josephine says. I'm worried you're going to come up a little short. I don't know, maybe.
It's Nevada. I'm not supposed to let anyone make long-distance phone calls.
Not a call, it's an electronic mail, email, you know, the internet.
Pick up! I wonder if we could find people on the web.
Why not? It does everything else.
Ready? Stop signs make people stop. They stop, they buy things.
Here, let me see what I can find.
State governments. Pennsylvania.
Well, that's kind of weird. Yeah, boy, I never thought things would turn into that. Amazing. Okay, so I'm still here. Yeah, I'm watching it with you. We've got a progressive Democrat we're going to take a look at. Yeah, that was weird. Very strange.
Regarding the question as to climate.
Okay, a couple things we'll get to in just a second. But first, a progressive Democrat, O'Rourke, you're listening to his campaign here. Betty O'Rourke.
It's a town of 1,200 people.
Welcome to Jeff Davis County in Fort Davis, Texas.
So how many of you registered to vote?
This is a huge, huge turnout for this little town.
We're proud that you're here. This is standing room crowd only. Here comes Beto, our next senator of the United States. Beto O'Rourke, my pleasure to introduce you. Thank you. Hey, how's everybody doing? Good to see you all. Good to be out with you. Good evening.
With fewer now than 100 days left before we decide the future, the fate, and the fortune, not just of Texas, but of this country together. No pressure, Fort Davis, but it's on us right now to make sure that we stand up and that we are more than a match for the things that concern us. The lack of decency and dignity and civility in public life right now that we need to restore, and all of us can be about that.
I feel like people are tired of what is coming out of Washington right now.
Okay, I've seen enough. Thank you. Right. All right. Thank you.
Climate change, I think the president was fairly straightforward. We're not spending money on that anymore. We consider that to be a waste of your money.
And so for those of you who are not from California, I always like to say, you know, stay tuned.
As I said, we have raised the temperature of the planet 1 degree, and we seem certain to come close to raising it 2, even if we did everything right, but we're not doing everything right on the current track at which we're emitting CO2. We're going to raise the temperature 4 or 5 degrees Celsius, 7, 8, 9 degrees Fahrenheit before this century is out. And if we do that, then we cannot have a civilization like the one we enjoy in any of its dimensions. Just think about how profoundly transformed that world would be.
And I love your analogy, because there is a major asteroid heading towards the Earth, and that asteroid should be labeled climate change. And maybe we take it with a greater sense of urgency if it was.
How much heat are we trapping? This is an interesting graphic. The extra energy trapped by human-made greenhouse gases is equivalent to 400,000 Hiroshima atomic bombs exploding every day, 365 days per year.
Basically,
Very few people know what SCAG is. We know what it is because we're involved in this world. Southern California Association of Governments covers 19 million people in Southern California. They are an unelected, hugely funded shadow government that their mandate is to put essentially everybody out of their cars. And it's, if you go to SCAG's website, they have a $540 billion plan that's supposedly going to go through 2040 to completely remake Southern California. And just to put that in perspective, the Marshall Plan, where we paid to rebuild Europe after World War II,
right,
cost about two-thirds less in today's dollars. So my question is, what exactly are they planning to do with all that money? And it's completely rework the roadways. This is all based on the thing called sustainable development that your listeners may or may not know about. But it is a fairly radical environmentalist idea that believes in global warming, believes cars are the thing that is causing it, and it works to get everybody out of their cars into public transportation on bikes and on foot.
The central plan is called a regional transportation plan. It's actually a federal environmental document that makes sure that everything that we do in our region reaches all of the environmental impact targets that we have in Southern California. The total cost to implement the plan is about $500 billion.
First of all, it's great to be in Long Beach, California, in the Southern California mega region.
Now, in our research, we identified 11 different mega regions throughout the country. And what we had to determine a mega region is a center of economic, social, and infrastructure ties throughout the country. And as you see with the Southern California mega region, it goes through Southern California and also touches on Las Vegas. We have an people from Nevada here.
Last night, the State Assembly passed Senate Bill 100.
We believe that every Californian deserves a real shot at the California dream. That we believe that our children deserve to breathe clean air and support a 100% clean energy future.
Senate Bill 100 calls for the state of California to rely exclusively, that is 100%, on renewable energy by 2045. Now, this is very important. People don't seem to realize what 100% actually means. As it is currently, renewable energy and fossil fuel energy are working in conjunction with each other. It has been proven that as of right now in this period of history, it is not possible to have renewable energy without traditional energy backup systems. People who are on wind and solar are using coal-based electricity when the wind isn't blowing or the sun isn't shining. So when these global warming, maniacal, earth-worshipping climate change freaks say 100%, what they are saying is that we have to eliminate the backup systems and use only renewable power. According to the state of California, coal-based electricity is not renewable power. According to the state of California, gasoline is not considered a renewable power. Therefore, when they say 100% renewable power, what they are saying is that it is their intention to ban all electricity and gasoline by the year 2045.
Look, I take it you're not surprised that when the state of California says in law we're going to cut the sales of the most powerful industry in the world by 50%, that there's some resistance. This is not a 6-month program. This is at least a 6-year program. or longer effort to turn our whole economy, because in fact we depend on oil. Oil, everyone got here with oil. Oil is at the heart of modern prosperity, and yet it has the destructive impact that it's going to undermine that prosperity very quickly. So we have to move off it. Moving off it takes hundreds of billions of dollars of investment.
Okay, stop right there. So you understand where he's coming from. We haven't exaggerated this. He wants to remove oil from our society.
And so what Francis himself says, all Christians need an ecological conversion, whereby the effects of their encounter with Jesus Christ become evident in their relationship with the world around them. And so then he goes into the substructure of a converted consciousness that's not just global, but what is it that's underneath a global consciousness conversion? It is national and local consciousness change. It's cultural change at a local level.
There seems to be an unspoken assumption here that any increase in gas price is bad. If there is an uptick, certainly that would be an extra burden on low-income families. But on the other hand, part of this system is the consumer. And if there is an uptick in gas prices, we'll probably react to it by driving less, which we know could have some good effects, like greatly reducing the traffic on the 405. And might make different decisions about what kind of cars they buy instead of gas guzzlers that we're looking for in the new electrics. There would be less pollution in the air.
I take responsibility for the pain that my decision will cause you. I'm going to vote to take away your parking, because when I look at the bigger picture, I'm responsible to the bigger picture. People talk about inconvenience. I know it's not just going to be an inconvenience for you. You're going to suffer, and I appreciate that, and I'm responsible for that, and I'll take the responsibility for it. But this decision that we're making tonight is 50 years into the future, 100 years into the future, and that's my job, is to make that decision.
We're walking, biking, and taking transit more and driving less. With sidewalks everywhere, walking and biking routes, and improvements that make it easier and more convenient to take transit.
I'm a 33-year-old college graduate, and one thing that I did learn at college is new urbanism, and I think this is a perfect example of it. Instead of sprawling out into vast developments as we have in the past as a society, I think contracting our developments into a dense population where we have public access to transportation and the rail and the airport, I feel like we would be able to release ourselves from cars, from our carbon footprint on this planet.
It is only a matter of time before taxis as we know them are gone, car ownership as we know it is gone.
How do you get people out of their cars?
Get out of their cars.
Getting out of our cars. And get out of our cars.
Get out of their cars.
That will get people out of their cars.
So the whole effort here is to get people off of their cars.
And what you're doing here today, this saves lives for people who want to buy them. And then when gas goes up to $5, $6, $7 a gallon, people are going to have to ride.
Here we are, Buellton, with their massive bike lane program, because this is sustainability. Small town, less than 5,000 people, probably never any traffic going down this street, but we need a massive bike lane so that no one rides down the street. There should be two lanes. So you see that? They have two lanes on this side, but only one lane on this side. And they expect nothing to go wrong with that. And you haven't seen a single bicyclist yet. Look how dumb this is.
It's ugly.
Seriously, like, look at this. There are cars in between the bike lane. So you have to ride in between two sets of cars.
It's really, when I saw it, I said, oh, God, Gary would die.
I mean...
And he just crossed into the bike lane. And they say it's for safety.
There's nobody there.
Well, of course there's not, because people aren't stupid enough to ride a...
And the idea there is that these could be what are sometimes called bicycle boulevards.
It feels to me like the government is planning for poverty. Long term, 30, 40, 50 years from now, they're planning for poverty.
We also have to spend time in educating the younger population on the value of transit. And because as they become the new riders or the new users of public transportation, we have to find a way to guide them away from the single cars and understanding the value of transit. We also have to spend time because we have a number of baby boomers who are retiring in place. So we have to find ways to teach those folks on using public transit, because the majority of us in here today have grown up with cars, and now we have to look at a new way of transporting people as the population grows. So we have to be more agile with technology. We have to look at how we with complete streets. We have to look at how complete streets look at walking, biking, public transportation. And we have to educate two populations that are growing tremendously in this area and in the country, the younger population and the aging baby boomers.
They're known as the octopus.
Oh. Hey, bus. 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 Wow, look at all these buses. This is crazy. Oh, my God. What's happening right now? Why is there so many buses?
And most of them are empty.
Okay, there's the Eyewitness News van.
We have to learn how to generate energy in a more sustainable way.
And a lot of whereas is probably the most important whereas. To ensure a sustainable, livable environment, we must reduce the solid and hazardous discards of our modern American lifestyle and imitate Earth's natural system in which waste becomes a resource.
You know, if you're thinking about what do you want Fontana to be known for, maybe Fontana can be the most sustainable city in the Inland Empire.
Sustainability is rational. It is being forced to use less of everything. Less water, they've got that covered already. Less energy, they are attempting that with renewables. Renewable energy is a giant crony capitalist scam where the government picks winners and losers and props up film industry by a cap and trade. Less food, that's being worked on by the United Nations right now. Less mobility. I cannot believe you guys think we are so stupid that people are actually going to believe that going from a car to a bus or a bike is somehow getting around quicker. Seriously, that's insane. Less freedom. Freedom is choice, and you are destroying our choices with this plan.
If everybody's raising living standards to the point where everybody's got a car, and everybody's got air conditioning, and everybody's got a big house, well, the planet will boil over.
So actually that would, because the state of California is, you know, pushing so many, you know, conservation efforts and, you know, renewable energy and everything.
California is pushing net zero. And if anyone knows anything about net zero, it's going to be net zero water, net zero energy.
And it will cost them more money, because it is a fact that renewables cost more money.
And of course, there's the 100% option, for which customers could expect to pay about a 6% premium compared to Edison's standard option. So if you have somebody who wanted to know that their power is coming from 100% renewable sources and didn't mind spending $6 more a month on their electrical bill, they could choose to do so.
When teachers and the district embrace the solar curriculum, we'll be there to continue that support over time so that there's a way to make sure these systems are really bringing that extra value to the educational side.
Under my plan of a cap and trade system, electricity rates would necessarily skyrocket. Even, you know, regardless of what I say about whether coal is good or bad, because I'm capping greenhouse gases, coal power plants, you know, natural gas, you name whatever the plants were, whatever the industry was, they would have to retrofit their operations. That will cost money. They will pass that money on to consumers.
This is communist United Nations agenda, which will tell you when to live, when you have to live, what kind of car you would like, if you have to drive. But they will live in, like, I am an Armenian, and Armenia was a communist country for 75 years. I know all government and equal opportunity poor citizens. And that's what they want to do to our cities.
Because the record speaks for itself by nearly any objective measure. Today's California is thriving, not in spite of these progressive policies, but because of these progressive policies. It is my role and responsibility to do everything within my power to help improve the human condition for all individuals. But guess what, fellow Democrats? That also means Trump supporter as well. Because when I fight for cleaner air, when I fight to make sure that we move policies that help improve the human condition for all individuals, as we all know, it's not just for Democrats, but it's for Trump supporters as well. Because they benefit from raising the minimum wage to $15. Am I right?
That's right!
They benefit from cleaner air. Am I right?
That's right!
They benefit from high wages. Am I right?
That's right!
And we're proud to be a progressive Democrat. Not just in name, but in action. From education to the environment, from high wages to health care, to human rights. California is proof positive that progressive values put into action improve the human condition.
This is a video that is going to show you what a transit-oriented development really is. So watch it for a second. So the train goes. Coming soon to the neighborhood near you, right?
I'll be upfront with all of you. I was actually supposed to be uploading a whole different video. The video is completed. It was just being exported from Final Cut. And now that video is going to have to wait because this video, I'm going to upload it first because of just how urgent this one is. Nonetheless, my wife showed me this video about what's taking place in China. For those of you that are putting your children in schools, I highly recommend homeschooling your children. And this is the reason why. They're coming for your children. And don't let this be like I'm trying to scare you or whatever. I'm telling you the truth. They're coming for your kids. Whether you believe it or not, they're coming for your children. They want your children. They want to claim your children for themselves. So they can do whatever they want to your children. Hey, as long as you are too busy working, as long as you, the husband, or you, the wife, you're both working at different times, and you don't really have enough time with the children, they own your children. Because guess what? The majority of the time that these children spend in schools, they are becoming more tightly bonded to their friends and their peers and their teachers rather than their parents. The Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, before I go any further, I want to share with you this video right now so that you can see exactly why I'm frustrated. Let's roll the clip. All of us are going to watch this together. I'm going to stay on screen. You see what I'm seeing? What I'm just showing you right now, what you have seen is a pole dancer, a stripper, a strip dancer. Now, what is she doing? If you pay close attention to the children, that's the audience. It's a kindergarten. These kindergarten kids are there. They are being welcomed to school by a pole dancer. Outrageous, correct? Yes. Some of you probably don't find this outrageous. You probably think it's normal. This is not normal, my friends. This is not something that should be brought for kindergartens. This should be something that should be never brought up, period. I can kind of understand if, let's say, they brought in a pole dancer to university students. But even then, that is not right. Because now schools are being turned into a place for sexual fantasies. These little children, their brains are still forming. Did you know the first 7 or 8 years of a child's life will determine who that child is going to be? So if that child learns about strippers, and if that child is accustomed to seeing a woman strip down, the girls are going to start thinking, wow, I want to be just like her. And the reason is because they're going to see their fellow peers, their boys. They're going to be like, wow, I want that woman. Wow, she's so gorgeous. Wow, look at her skin. Look how... I'm not even going to start putting images in your heads, but you get the idea. This is frustrating. Now, I'm going to share with you something. I had a dream several years ago. And in fact, actually, this dream, I shared it here on YouTube. I believe it was in 2010 or late 2009. Anyways, here's the dream. I'm only just going to skip to the main point that actually fits in with what is about to take place. What I believe is that we're about to see in the world today. Because in this dream, I was taken to the nearby future. Now, what I was able to see in the dream was I saw a lineup of people. I saw adults and I saw children standing in long lineups, and they were all standing to enter into nightclubs, and I saw that they would get in and they would get out, both old and young, middle-aged people of all ages, different classes of society. The atmosphere, the air seemed kind of dull. It looked almost grayish. It did not appear to be a clean atmosphere. I saw people smoking, and then I saw women dressed in such a provocative manner that they were pretty much naked in public, women. And then I began to look around, and then I saw men. Men also were dressed provocative. And it was in such a way that the men whom I saw in my dream, they all appeared to be dressed like women. So they were almost dressed feminine. Men dressed like women with skirts. Others were dressed in such a way that it's just bizarre. And then when I saw the children too also were dressed provocative. And then the children were running around on the streets, running uncontrollably. These children in my dream, they appeared to be at the age of about maybe, let's say, 9 years old, 10 years old. I did not see younger ones, but there could be other ones that were younger than that. But this was what I was observing. It was almost as if the time which I saw in my dream, or in this vision-like dream, because it appeared more like a vision. What I saw was that it was almost as if the age of consent had been lowered in such a way that it was now okay for children to go to wander to and fro, get in and out of nightclubs freely, and they were able to associate themselves with men and women, or even their peers, or people of all different classes, without having a parent next to them. That was what I saw in my vision, in this dream. It was like a vision-like dream. Now, that, I believe, is where we are heading as a society. The reason I shared with you this dream is because now when we see these kinds of events, where we see these strippers dancing in elementary schools, dancing in front of children, kindergartners, between the ages of 3 and 6, that is wrong. In Romans 1, 26 to 32, the Bible says the following: "For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge."
Dr. David Groves is a physicist in the UK and a specialist in image processing.
I've been involved in image analysis for 25 years now. I did my PhD developing holographic computer techniques for analysing images. My company, Quantic Image Processing, use these image processing techniques to extract three-dimensional information from two-dimensional images used in industry and used in medicine. The NASA pictures that I've analyzed contain many inconsistencies, a whole core of which have no rational explanation or excuse.
David Groves of Quantech Image Processing, using the technological resources at his command, has traced this secondary light source and been able to calculate exactly where an additional light was placed in relation to the camera.
If you magnify the photograph and look at the boundary of the porch through which the astronaut is exiting, you can see a fine shadow line around the porch perimeter. This shadow line shows that you have a well-localized source of light to the right of the camera. Most interestingly, there is a hot spot on the heel protector of the astronaut's right-hand boot. This allows us to do some quantitative measurement. We had access to one of these boots with a heel protector from which we could measure very accurately the curvature of that heel protector. Knowing again the focal length of the camera lens, the position of that hot spot on the heel protector, and the orientation of the boot in the photograph, we could determine the light path to that source of illumination. The light source is between 24 and 36 centimeters to the right of the camera, an ideal position for artificial lighting.
So it's now been established beyond argument that an artificial light source was used. We even know where it was placed for the photography of this important sequence of Aldrin descending the ladder. At this point, you might say, well, surely they can use extra lighting if they want to. What's wrong with that?
According to NASA, the astronauts didn't take any lighting to the moon. And we can prove that there was no lighting. The TV coverage of this event demonstrates this fact. In the TV footage, we can see Armstrong standing at the foot of the ladder as Aldrin descends, supposedly taking the still photos, which are the official record of this event. Aldrin is in darkness. Aldrin is not lit. Yet the published still photo sequence clearly indicates the use of an artificial light source. Did Armstrong really take these still photos during Aldrin's descent on the moon? In our opinion, probably not. We propose that this is a completely restaged, or rather, pre-staged set of studio photographs.
So, wherever the Aldrin descending the ladder sequence of stills was taken, an artificial source of light was deployed.
I know that they had no extra lightning, no flashes or things like that, so it has to be the reflection from the surface.
That the astronaut will be adequately lit whilst in the shadow side of the LEM, solely from natural light or earthshine bouncing off the lunar surface, is an argument advanced by others as well as Jan Lundberg, but it's untenable. To make a direct comparison, the surface of the moon on average has the ability to reflect light from any source whatsoever, at whatever distance from its surface, to the same degree as asphalt does on Earth, on average approximately 7%. In other words, whatever the strength of the light arriving on the lunar surface, whether by natural or other means, the ability of the average lunar surface to reflect light remains constant. Indeed, the lunar surface luminosity is so low it doesn't even manage to illuminate the shadow side of the smallest rocks, as we've already seen. Here's another good example. The sun, or prime light source, is behind the LEM. This picture is taken into the light, so the side of the craft nearest to us should be absolutely black, but has been filled in with a generous amount of light. Particularly obvious is this piece of equipment illuminated from the front.
That sequence of images on the lunar surface, taken mainly by Armstrong, of course, on that with that one camera, which was incidentally left on the moon, so it's going to be a marvelous relic for when we eventually get back there, of course. The film came back. That film, probably, I would say, has never ever been bettered, whether on the moon or subsequently. Almost every one of those relatively small number of images taken by Armstrong appeared to be splendidly composed. You remember the classic face-on picture of Aldrin with his visor reflecting the entire landing scene, the lunar module, the flag, the TV camera, and Armstrong taking the picture reflected in the visor. It's a marvelous picture.
With that comment, H.J.P. Arnold has led us to another of the classic Apollo 11 images. In fact, one could say that this particular shot conveys the very essence of the entire Apollo program. Yet this classic picture of Aldrin has several very serious problems.
Aldrin cannot be standing in natural sunlight in this image because the surface around him is not evenly lit, as would be the case with light from the sun. This scene is obviously lit with uneven artificial lighting. The prime source of light is over Aldrin's left shoulder. The light is emanating from this direction. We know this is so because we can see what photographers call fall-off in the top left, the top right, and the left foreground. This fall-off effect is the name given to darker areas caused by lighting a subject with a non-uniform source of light, lighting that does not have enough spread, as this false color version particularly reveals. Secondly, we can see that our old friend the fill-in light has again been used to illuminate the suit detail on Aldrin's right-hand side, the left of the picture. The camera position itself is also in doubt, for we seem to be looking down on the astronaut. How can we tell if that's so? Well, recalling the large center reticle cannot be anywhere but in the center of the image, we're surprised to find that this reticle is over the lower part of Aldrin's right leg. The Hasselblad camera was attached to the astronaut's chest at the time, and so the center of the image should be over the abdominal area of the subject. This lower leg position for the center reticle strongly indicates that the camera was in fact positioned at a higher level. As this graphic demonstrates, the center of the picture can only be over the subject's lower leg if the camera is positioned at eye level and then tilted down. The camera height and tilt angle was calculated by David Groves. This fact represents another serious problem. The reflection of this scene mirrored in the astronaut's visor shows the astrophotographer with his camera clearly positioned at chest level, which actually cannot be. So this false reflection must have been composited or painted in over the original image. The reflection we see in the visor cannot be that of the photographer of the image.
The horizon is a very good datum. On the moon, the horizon effectively acts as a spirit level. We know it's about 89 degrees from the true vertical. Therefore, the position of the horizon cutting through the image of the astronaut shows us the level of the camera when the picture was taken. And if we look at the picture, we can see the horizon cuts very nicely at face level. The camera taking the photograph could have been positioned on the chest of an astronaut, and that astronaut could have been about 2 foot higher than the astronaut that was being photographed. To this end, we could analyze the shadow in the image. Basically, the information we have and can make use of is we know the width of the visor in the image, the focal length of the lens used on the camera. Using that information, we can analyze the shadow of the astronaut's left leg and determine between the two astronauts the variation in height of the surface. The variation in height of the surface between the astronauts is typically a few inches. It would have to actually be 2 feet to explain the incorrect positioning of the camera when the image was taken.
I'll be honest with you, I think that's pseudo-scientific, nitpicky claptrap. And again, I don't know why we should spend even a moment trying to judge that.
But as we've seen, there are indeed crucial problems with the photographs. This is the point. The so-described nitpicky, pseudo-scientific claptrap is not pseudo at all. The analysis has been undertaken based on the laws of physics. Fortunately, the information encrypted within these images has survived the voyage across 3 decades and is now being decoded by people like Percy and Groves. The proof is in the DEMS.
Fallen silent shroud of snow. I am a rock, I am an island. I built walls, a fortress deep and mighty that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I am a rock, I am an island. Don't talk of love. Well, I've heard the word before. It's sleeping in my memory. I won't disturb the slumber of feelings that have died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I am a rock, I am an island. I have my purpose. protect me. I am shielded in my armor, hiding in my room, safe within my womb. I touch no one and no one touches me. I am a rock, I am an island. And a rock feels no pain, and an island never cries.
Welcome to the show, everyone. Thank you for coming in. We're doing lots of fun stuff tonight. We are breaking ground here. We're in the 11th hour of a 12-hour half telethon, first of its kind. Yeah, this is we're in a historic moment for America's Third Party, the longest running television show on the internet. We're out way ahead of everybody now, making this telethon a dedication to Jerry Lewis. And what a waste of time it was of him collecting all that money for the evil, corrupt big pharma industry. And muscular dystrophy is still just as bad as it was when he was alive. So the sooner we wake up to what's really happening, you know, the telethon really is an awareness telethon. You don't have to spend any money here and make donations. You just have to become aware that we're being played. And there's a strong need for a third party. And I had a couple people in here tonight who continue to support the Democratic Party. And the only reason why I'm suggesting people vote for Democrats in the upcoming midterms in the House and Republicans in the Senate is because we need balance. We don't have balance. So I don't in any way endorse Democrats. And I think the sad fact is we haven't built a third party because of the censorship that's been going on. And if you don't recognize that, then you're a complete fool. Now, our show has been censored at the highest levels. And there's a reason why they're doing this, because they don't want anyone to form a political union in this country. We're completely controlled. So I don't mind telling you that this is a challenge we're all going to face, that the two parties have been bought off. And if you ever expect any change, substantive change in our country, then you're going to have to recognize the need for a third party. So I know a lot of you are just kind of dabbling in what we do here. I've been doing this for 9 years. I can tell you, you're wasting my time and yours thinking that somehow the Democrats or the Republicans are going to pull a rabbit out of their ass. Because they're not. They're never going to stop genetically modified food from dominating our planet. They're never going to stop big pharma or the vaccine industry from poisoning our children. And they're never going to stop this desecration of this planet by pesticides and herbicides. They're going to continue to engage in voodoo economics, just like Trump did. He lost $1,700 billion in taxes when he gave the big rich people a $1.7 trillion tax break. And he overspent by $500 billion in the past 6 months. And this is, by definition, voodoo economics. Now, you can take it or leave it. Modern economists don't acknowledge the existence of voodoo economics, but the basis is completely there for a complete collapse in our economy. You can't keep borrowing money to get out of debt. Just like you can't keep fighting wars to create peace. So we've got it all wrong. The two-party system has screwed everything up. It's going to be a lot of unwinding and reworking foreign policy to rebuild from the mistakes that Trump has made over the past 6 months to a year. This trade embargo is a disaster, or this trade tariff plan is a disaster, which is only leading to drops and declines in all economies. Brokering a deal with Mexico without getting Canada on board, alienating Trudeau, all of this is part of the mistakes that Donald Trump is making right now. So, anyway, we're in the 2 p.m. to 2 a.m. half telethon. I'm still in the final hour. We've got 40 minutes left. This is a song I play at night just to feel enjoyed, like I enjoy the evening when I play this song. And I don't know why. I can't tell you why, but I like the way she sings it. Yeah.
Why are Subaru Outback owners always smiling? Because Subaru Outback holds its value better than any other vehicle in its class, according to ALG. Even better than Toyota RAV4. Go with the industry leader, Subaru Outback.
Have been asking for ever since I started doing the Dolly Show. They asked me why I didn't sing the song about Jolene. Now, this is a true story for those of you that don't know. I wrote this song about 20 years ago about this woman down in Nashville that worked at the bank. She was trying to take care of my husband while I was out on the road. Well, that didn't go over too big with me. I fought that red-headed woman like a wildcat. She jerked my wig off and almost beat me to death with it. But I kept my husband. I got that sucker home and I beat the tar out of him. We got a whole bunch of red-headed women down here. As a matter of fact, Jolene looked a whole lot like you. You red-headed husband. Oh, so here we go with the pitiful story of Jolene. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Oh, I'm begging of you, please don't take my man. Jolene, 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 Jolene. Please don't take him just because you can. Your beauty is beyond compare with flaming locks of auburn hair. Emerald green. Your smile is like a breath of spring. Your voice is soft like summer rain. Well, I cannot compete with you, Jolene. He talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do to keep from crying. lonely. Oh, but I can easily understand how you could easily take my man, but you don't know what he means to me, Tony. Choice of men, but I could never love again, 'cause he's the only one for me, Jolene. I had to have this talk with you. My happiness depends on you, and whatever you decide you'll do, Jolene.
Okay, this just came in. This has been translated into the English so we can read it, but a few days ago, the ISS suffered an impact that opened a small hole in its helmet. Soon after, astronaut Chris Hadfield tweeted about it, along with an image of a hole caused by space junk. So this is pretty funny. When your spaceship suddenly starts leaking air, you fix the hole with duct tape and a gob of epoxy. Nice save, guy. Yeah. Who'd ever thought duct tape and epoxy would work in space? Good job. Yeah. We believe that. Sure. We'll believe anything you tell us, because we're just mindless idiots. All right, that was wonderful. Miley, thank you for being you. Here's an interesting little story about a plane that we don't seem to want to fly anymore, even though they were perfectly good.
We had it. From January 21st, 1976 to October 24th, 2003, we had a commercial supersonic passenger plane called Concorde. Today, it takes 7 hours to fly from New York to London. On the Concorde, it took about 3 hours and 30 minutes, just under 3 hours if it was record time. A journey that would have taken the Titanic 137 hours had become just barely long enough to watch Titanic while crossing the Atlantic. The Concorde came to represent class, style, and the miracle of engineering. Here's a normal plane landing, and here's the Concorde landing. Which one are you looking at? With Concorde, we all looked up and pointed, and then in 2003, it stopped. We had commercial supersonic flight and just let it go. Why? Why did the Concorde become a museum exhibit? This is the Smithsonian's Concorde, and the curator who got it flew on it, too.
I did see, you know, the color of the sky at 60,000 feet. It's this most gorgeous, deep, deep purple.
How did a breakthrough become a piece of memorabilia? The answer says something about how innovation really sticks, and it's complicated.
I've got a personal interest in the SST, and I'd like to tell you about it.
SST equals supersonic transport. Any transportation that's faster than the speed of sound. It became a dream after Chuck Yeager broke the sound barrier in 1947, and a technological race in the 1950s and 1960s combined Cold War competition with a classic mid-century faith in engineering. Americans, Russians, and the British and French governments dumped hundreds of millions of dollars into supersonic R&D. Think rooms full of engineers in short sleeves and ties. The then Seattle-based Boeing won the American design contract in 1967. That's where a certain basketball team got its original name.
Supersonic, win the game!
But development stopped after a 1971 funding cut. Russia's effort, the Tupolev Tu-144, flew, but it was grounded after an extraordinarily spotty record over just 55 flights. But there was a winner.
Concorde, the paper dark jetliner conceived jointly by Britain and France to shrink the world and cut air journey times in half.
From the beginning, Concorde was a marvel of design. It wasn't designed with computers, but through math and trial and error. They had to innovate constantly to make a supersonic passenger plane possible.
The airplane needed to be very long and narrow to go supersonically comfortably.
And the paint was twice as reflective as other jets, just to compensate for the heat from air friction.
Because you're traveling at Mach 2, twice the speed of sound, even though you're at 60,000 feet, the airframe would actually heat up dramatically. So I actually, you know, touched the window. It wasn't warm, it was hot.
Fuel flowed around the plane during flight to adjust its center of gravity for takeoff, cruising, and landing.
So these pumps are working the whole flight, but you can't tell.
But it was the beautiful wing that distinguished the Concorde for its greatest fans.
It's a delta wing, but it's called an ogival delta wing because of its unique shape.
Delta because it was triangular, like the Greek delta. Ogival to reference its curve. The delta wing helped the Concorde get lift at takeoff and limit drag while in flight. The rest of the plane compensated.
The one compromise in it required the aircraft to have a very high angle of attack on takeoff and landing.
Since pilots couldn't see out of the plane because of angled landing, engineers put together a solution.
The Concorde featured a droop snoot.
Droop snoot?
Yeah, the snoot would droop.
The snoot drooped.
The reason being that it was a delta wing design and it had a very high angle of attack on landing. So in order to see, they were able to lower the nose.
It flew at Mach 2, more than 1,300 miles an hour, faster than the Earth spins.
You couldn't tell. The only way you knew you're doing Mach 2 was that they had a Mach meter up on the bulkhead. And everybody was focused on that because it would creep up. And as soon as it went Mach 1, everybody would break out into applause.
To minimize drag, it soared so high you could see the Earth's curve. The Concorde defined the glamour of high-speed flight.
Now, this is a very important part of the seven-piece wardrobe, this washable dress that she wears in hot climates.
And it had the admiration of celebrities like Sting.
It's always exciting flying supersonic, and it's always exciting to get to New York before you've left.
It was a stratospheric cocktail party.
Normally people complain about how bad the airline food is. I will attest, in this case, that was not true. This was one of the best meals I ever had. It worked beautifully. A normal French meal takes 2.5-3 hours. Well, by the time dinner was over, we were here.
So, what went wrong? On July 25th, 2000, the Concorde punctured a tire during takeoff for Air France Flight 4590. 113 people died. Though failure happened shortly after takeoff, it was due to a problem specific to Concorde tires. The plane was grounded until November of 2001. By that time, the September 11th attacks had already depressed the industry. But while both tragedies did affect Concorde, there are only a couple of pieces of the fundamental challenges for the plane. Noise levels on takeoff were high, but massive supersonic booms had no comparison. In the 60s, the Air Force ran a test of sonic booms over Oklahoma City, and residents reported hundreds of damaged windows and noise disturbances. All that meant limiting supersonic flight to above the ocean. There would be no New York to LA Concorde. That's part of what quashed the American supersonic experiment with Boeing, and it limited demand for supersonic planes from the beginning. Noise concerns were paired with environmental concerns.
There will be severe environmental damage to the ozone layer.
The plane's high flight pattern made scientists think its exhaust gas could be more threatening to the ozone than normal jets.
What was...
Right, the ozone effect. Right, we wouldn't want to jeopardize the ozone. After all, we eliminated Freon from all of our air conditioning units and refrigerators so that we could open up an opportunity to start doing this. Right, aerial spraying. Right. I have to break through to, what's Conspiracy Monday without a little bit of chemtrail cowboy? Let's face it, we've been doused with ozone-depleting carbon all over the place. I mean, who's kidding who? I'm quite surprised that we even talk about it in a daily show and nobody seems to care.
Kimmy's in the air, everywhere I look around. Kimmy's in the air, falling down to the ground. And I don't know if I'm being foolish, don't know if I'm being wise, but there's something that I must believe in, and they're there when I look to the sky. Kimmy's in the air, falling fibers in the tree. Kimmy's in the air, for all of us to see. I don't know if I'm just dreaming, don't know if I feel.
Cold beer, staring at the floor, cause it's fine. season's over and I'm knocking on heaven's door. Maybe then I'll realize what I went wrong before. There's too many of you dying, victims of the mob. But I tell the devil and he'll agree that I was only doing my job. Yes, son, a chemtrail cowboy, proud of what I do. Well, I couldn't care less for my family, and I don't give a fuck about you. Yeah, I'm a chemtrail cowboy, spraying over you. Well, I don't care about the environment, and I don't give a fuck about you.
You know, I never really had a chance to hear that version. Thank you so much for tuning me into that. I'll add it to my library on chemtrails. Yeah, that's powerful. Chemtrail Cowboy. Nice. It's there. Good. This next piece is beautiful. Yeah, we're right above the... You're very fun, dude. Thanks. Well, we're right above the beautiful Los Angeles, where people spent their whole life wondering why they're still stuck there. And I got out of the LA 25 years ago, roughly. Well, not really. Well, yeah. 25 years ago. Amazing. Yeah. I know people that still live there and are going to die there. You know, it's kind of pathetic. But anyway, this next video is about a guy who runs into people who are constantly trying to fish him on scamming online, you know, things your grandpa would fall for. And he acts like grandma, and he uses a voice modulator so he can actually talk to these people.
How can I help you today?
He can actually talk to these people, so and he speaks their language, and he basically screws with them. And these people are trying to rip your grandma and grandpa off, claiming that, you know, any website could have this malicious software warning and your virus has attacked your Microsoft computer and they're going to clean it up for $499. It's crazy. So he actually gets into these people's heads and talks to them.
Daddy? Yes, I'm calling
yes, ma'am.
about a problem with my laptop that I'm hoping you'll be able to help me with.
No problem. I will help you further. No problem, miss. Can you tell me what is the problem you have with the laptop?
Yes, Abby, it's real. It's weird. You see, I had a couple cats, you know, and I like to make sure they're fed real healthy like. And so I was looking up some recipes about how to bake my own cat food. And then out of nowhere, like, I got a message from you, from Windows, and it was talking about a virus. And I've never never seen that before. I mean, what is all that?
Let me tell you what happened. Relax.
Okay.
Right now, you're using a good computer that is a micro...
Should I stop using it?
Calm down.
Okay, I'll
speak now.
Hold on, let me just take a sip of my tea.
All I want, have patience with me, and everything will be good to go. That's my promise to you, okay?
Okay, just have some patience.
That's it. Do you have patience?
I guess.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Sometimes it's difficult, you know, I do have a lot of cats, so they have...
I can learn to understand you much better if I can get familiar with the way you talk. I need your permission to help.
I do have a cat at my home.
Oh, you
my,
do? What kind of cat do you have?
I'm really sorry. I don't know the breed. Actually, my mother feed the cat, right? I don't know much about them. But she's very cute, and the name was... what was his name? Her name is Kelly.
Kelly Cat.
Yeah, she's very cute. But I don't think so. I don't think so. She's more cuter than your cat.
I believe you could send some pictures that would make you think otherwise.
Oh, great. I believe your cat is more cuter than mine.
Okay, give me just one second. Let me see if I can get my cat over here. Hold on. I think he'd like to meet you very much. I have a kitty.
I do want to meet your cat.
Mr. Whiskers! Mr. Whiskers! Come here, Mr. Whiskers! He's coming.
Okay, all right. Oh!
He's such a good kitty. Hold on. Do you hear him? He's talking to you. Say hi.
Hello.
Hi. he likes you. Okay, all right, Mr. Whiskers, let's go ahead and go bye-bye now. All right, sir, are you still there with me?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here with you, and I will be with you. Don't worry, okay? And accidentally, okay. If we got disconnected, I will call you back, all right?
Okay, yeah. Yes, that's fine.
What you need to do now, you need to have a look on your keyboard, okay? Your keyboard.
Okay. Hold on.
Have a look on the very...
I'm just going to move a couple things around my desk. I'm going to need to get my bifocals out, I think, right? Oops. Okay, what am I looking for on the keyboard now? I used to play this game called Foursquare at recess. Have you ever played that?
So do one then? I do, ma'am. I do play that. Foursquare, I played the game Foursquare.
Yes, my friend Linda actually lost one of her teeth playing. We got so into it. I remembered someone elbowed her right in the face because, we used to get real aggressive. And we would put money on it. And at one point, one of the kids, we didn't use a normal ball. They put one of those, back then lead was perfectly legal, you know. So we actually filled one of the balls with lead and it was a real problem. Anyway, can I let go yet of this key?
No. While holding the four square key, you need to hold the letter R with the other finger. R as in Roger, okay?
Okay.
Keep holding the Windows button. Don't let the key go away.
Okay.
And with the other finger, hit and press the letter R.
Oh, run, save, cancel? That?
Yes. Hit on run. Grab a cup of your tea, and we got connected now. You can see it's me on the computer.
Okay.
Can you see my cursor moving around? My cursor is moving around, right?
What?
So we got connected.
Now
I'm on a computer, okay? Right? It's a scan going on there. All right? All right.
And what is it scanning for? That's a cool story, Bob. I mean, where did you learn this trick?
This is scanning for malicious files on a computer, okay?
And whatever is at the end is true, right?
And right. Everything will be under your name. I'm registering you for the one-time fiction. That is 199. Your name is R-O-S-E. And what is your last name? Confirm your last name once again.
It says there's scammers found on your computer. That's interesting. So... Windows found a scam. Wait a second. You've spent an hour lying to me, haven't you? These aren't warnings.
Yes, I do.
This isn't a bunch of viruses, are they?
I'm sorry?
I bet you've never fixed a single one of these in your life.
All right, yes, come, ma'am. Let me hang up the call.
You've never been able to fix them on anyone's computer, huh? You just kind of lie to them and take their money. You don't work for Microsoft either, do you?
Ma'am, I never told you that we work for Microsoft.
You're lying to yourself I told now,
you,
honey.
I told you that we provide online Windows support.
Okay, we're so not that, Microsoft. That's your cover-up. You just kind of trick people. Because I have a recording of you saying it. My phone records things. It's interesting.
Yeah.
But what? What are you saying now?
Leave your mouth now, ma'am.
Why would I need to do that? Just admit it. You don't have a job. What you're doing is you're cheating people out of money. And I know that there might be some sort of situation that got you here. But at the end of the day, what you're doing is wrong. It's absolutely wrong. In every
way. Can I have
a
real voice? Can I have a real voice? Can I have a real voice for a while?
This is my name.
No, I heard that before. I want to hear your real voice for a while.
This is my voice. Let me ask you this question. Did you scam me? Did you lie to me?
They hung up, if you couldn't tell. All these flavors, and you choose to be salty? Here's the thing. I mean, GG no re on that one. That was some scam. I think we've actually talked to that guy before as a different character. I want to say it was like Nevaeh or one of our other voices, but because that guy's laugh is somewhat memorable, but I don't think he's the guy on YouTube with the awkward laugh. I don't think it was, because he had a different name, and it was a little bit different. It was a little bit different, but Abby definitely is one of the guys that we've talked to before. I'm not sure why they wanted to hear my real voice. Maybe they are convinced that I don't know. For all I know, they're going to be like, record this. Watch out for him. But do you even have a cat named Kelly? Oh, that's what I should have said.
Americans lost their homes to foreclosure after the housing market collapsed. But an Indianapolis woman says she had a free ride for nearly a decade. Dean Reynolds shows us how the real estate downturn became her good fortune.
Wait for me. Don't leave me.
Lisa Hardy has been living in this Indianapolis house for 9 years without paying a penny in rent. You heard that right. Rent free.
Did any of it seem too good to be true? I mean, especially the part about paying no rent. No?
No.
I mean, that's not the way the world works, though, is it?
I can honestly say it's just an incredible circumstance.
A decade ago, Hardy was working for a real estate company that made her an offer she couldn't refuse.
What was the offer to you?
You and your family find a house and move in it.
The idea was that as long as she worked for the realtor, she'd have a house. So Hardy picked this 3-bedroom house, which the company owned, and moved in.
So you start to occupy this place with the understanding that you're going to stay there for...
There was really no time limit on how long I would be here. As time goes on, I'm thinking they were planning to put me on a lease.
But when her boss went to prison for mortgage fraud and the real estate company collapsed, Hardy stayed.
We're good.
For the next 9 years.
And this is Leah's playroom.
You raised your family here.
I did.
Were you nervous at all during these years that went by?
Yes. It had its ups and downs.
But she paid her utilities, installed new appliances, and went on with her life.
And you just stayed
here. and didn't hear a word from anyone.
The city, unaware there was an occupant, offered to auction off the home, which was built in 1910. Hardy actually tried to buy it at a bargain basement price, but each time it was pulled off the block for no apparent reason. Then, when it came on the market again 3 months ago, the asking price of $7,500 was too steep for Hardy.
Yeah, tell me about JFA.
Her story, while unusual, is no surprise to housing advocate Roger Rayburn.
Simply because the glut of houses that the city had under their control. There were so many to deal with, literally thousands, that it was impossible to keep up with.
This would not have happened had there not been a housing collapse, right?
Correct. This is just a pinprick of what happened nationwide.
At the last auction of the home in question, a company from Singapore, of all places, finally bought it.
What are you going to do?
I don't have an answer for that just yet.
But here's the best part of this story. The Singapore company has just told CBS This Morning it keep Hardy in the home.
These came when the roof started leaking.
Fix the roof and work out a deal for, yes, a monthly rental payment. Because this time around, the rent will be due. For
we are T-minus 18 seconds from liftoff. We're T-minus 15 seconds.
Would you and your men please follow me?
Hey, what the hell is this?
This is an emergency. Please follow me, now!
T-minus 10 seconds. 9, 8, we have ignition. 6, 5, we have outboard engines. 3, we have inboard engines. 1, 0, we have a launch commit. We have a liftoff at 35 minutes after the hour.
Every split second of this historic flight, every intimate detail, every heartbeat was monitored by Mission Control in Houston.
This is Capricorn 1. We have landed.
As millions all over the world watched and listened, the President of the United States spoke to the astronauts across the vastness of space.
To the men of Capricorn 1, I bring you greetings from your fellow Americans.
There's only one small catch. It never happened. It's all a lie. A fantastic $30 billion hoax.
Something's wrong, and I don't know what it is.
Dig deep enough, you might uncover the truth.
Those signals couldn't have come from 300 miles.
But the odds are, you'll never live to tell it.
Freeze!
I'm not moving an inch.
They're on the plane together! There's a device, it's on the plane. There's some people, if I don't give them the all clear signal, they'll explode it.
Something's wrong, something big. They know I'm onto it and they try to kill me.
Who's they?
I can't tell you.
We are dead.
You tell me you're in trouble, you're out on bail, you just got fired, I tell you I'll be right over.
My head hurts.
You look awful.
Thank you very much.
You're quite welcome.
These people, they're capable of anything.
You sound so close. It's hard to believe you really are that far away in space.
It's hard for me to believe it, too.
You're up to something. You want my help.
It's gotten out of control. It's too big.
Capricorn 1, this is Houston. Capricorn 1, we show red on the heat shield. Capricorn 1, this is Houston. We show red on the heat shield. Do you read?
Pull that lever down by your feet when I tell you, sonny.
Capricorn 1, the mission that never got off the ground.
orphan lives in a very bad part of town. And everybody, yeah, tries to put my Snoopy down. Snoopy, I don't care what your daddy do.
Day of WPIX, all programs included therein and their arrangement and compilation are protected by copyright and subject to this notice. All rights are reserved by WPIX Incorporated. At this time, WPIX New York leaves the air until tomorrow, when we'll resume with another schedule of the best in television. WPIX is owned and operated by WPIX Incorporated, with studios and offices at 220 East 42nd Street, New York City, and transmitter atop the Empire State Building. WPIX operates on Channel 11 as authorized by the Federal Communications Commission. Programs broadcast by this station may not be used for any purpose except exhibition at the time of their broadcast on receivers of the type ordinarily used for home reception in places where no admission, cover, or mechanical operating charges are made, nor can they be rebroadcast without express permission from WPIX. WPIX is a member of the Association of Independent Television Stations. May we suggest, if you'd like to spend some time now listening to New York's rock and roll...